part. So the first part is where my golden crown was supposed to stand. And when it's walk off streets of gold, we're supposed to stand. When it's shot hallelujah, we're supposed to stand. So we're going to try it again. From the top.
the ultimate sacrifice he made for us. I want you guys to sing your heart out, because he made the ultimate sacrifice for us, and that's what we're here today. So please, we're gonna try that again. Thank you.
Thank you. Psalms 27, verse 1. And the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is my strength and my life. Whom shall I be afraid? Now we need to all go on our knees for prayer. Thank you, Father. Thank you for this day. Thank you for guiding us and protecting us throughout the whole entire week. Lord, please wash all the sins we have committed and help those who are sick. And Lord, please bless all those who want a job. Also, help the speaker so that he can use his voice to bless us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen. Thank you.
Today's tithe and offering will be going toward this week's offering will be going towards to support the VOP Canada. Amen?
Amen.
And the Bible text that I would use for today's tithe and offering would be from Psalm 116, verse 12. And I read, "What shall I return to the Lord for all his goodness he's done to me?" Right? So once we reflect on those words, right? Anything from the goodness of your heart, you give to him. Whatever you give, obviously you receive by his faith and mercy. Amen? Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, as we bring our tithe and offering to your storehouse, Lord, we ask that you bless it unto the things that can be done towards other people, Lord. And Lord, and the ones that weren't able to give, Lord, please see through their heart so that they could give the following week. This is my prayer. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Happy birthday, boy. Yeah. It's a good time to
pray for whoever may be needing special prayers. Even as we celebrate today, we worship, and as we see our young people lead the service, and if you are very observant, you will notice that it's more than 95% or 98% ladies. Our boys are either hiding somewhere or they're not. So boys, come up. Yeah, it's good. But at the same time, we are missing some of them. Some are already in school, far away, but there are others who are around and are not worshiping with us. I was looking at the text in Matthew chapter 2 when King Herod, failing to identify the baby Christ, sent troops to Bethlehem to massacre the innocent children. And when Matthew was writing this under inspiration, he said that what Herod did was in fulfillment of a prophecy in Jeremiah, that a voice was heard in Ramah, lamentation, weeping, and great mourning. Rachel weeping for her children, refusing to be comforted because they are no more. But there is another promise that followed the weeping and the mourning of these mothers because their infants had been massacred. When you read that text from Jeremiah, it says the same thing boys heard in Ramah, lamentation and bitter weeping because Rachel is weeping for her children. And then a promise follows. Thus says the Lord from Jeremiah 31 verse 16. Refrain your voice from weeping and your eyes from tears, for your work shall be rewarded, says the Lord. And they shall come back from the land of the enemy. There is hope in your future, says the Lord, that your children shall come back to their own border. That is the wonderful promise of God. My plea is that our church will keep praying. Amen. For the children who are no more in the land of the enemy. Let us claim this promise that they will come back.
Amen.
The Lord will bring them back. So join us in midweek prayers. Join us during study time. Join us on Sunday morning prayers. Join us in family worship, wherever you are. Gather the children, pray for the children, pray for the young people, pray for those who are here and those who are in Coast No More, that the Lord, in His own time, according to His promise, will bring them back.
Amen.
I want to offer special prayers for those of us who may be in some special need. I know within the week I encountered some experience, a young man who was going through some sort of emotional disturbances. Pray for our young people, yes. Pray for our students who are studying. Pray for those who are here on and that don't have their permanent residence. Pray for those who are struggling with other issues. Yes, they need our support. They need our prayers. So at this time, I want to invite, if there is a special thank offering through about your birthday, come and join us. If you are a visiting brother or sister, come, let us pray together. And if you have a burden on your heart, bring it before the Lord. I invite you to come.
man. I'm able to trust to let us bow our heads and prayer. Oh God, our God, we offer you thanks and praises because you are our God, Almighty, creator of the heavens and the earth. We bow before you, recognizing that, O Lord, by your grace and mercy, we are alive unto this day. We want to, O Lord, on behalf of our brethren who are celebrating their birthday, give you thanks and praise. And Lord, we ask that on this year special day, on this year special week, you pour abundant blessings upon them. Yes. Remember them, Lord. Let them experience another year, a year of abundant blessing. Amen. And all of your people present themselves before you. They are not coming because of me. They are coming because of you, Lord.
Amen.
Today is a Sabbath day, a day in which, Lord, you healed. So stretch forth your mighty hand upon those who are sick and heal them. The day that you brought relief to the captives and to the oppressed, to the troubled, those who are agonizing in pain and misery. Lord, lift up your mighty hand. Lift up your hand against the enemy who have surrounded your people with so many troubles. By your grace, Lord, cause your people to be released from his oppression.
Amen.
Whatever their emotional problems are, mental agony are, their physical problems are, we pray in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
That you will touch them with a special touch.
Amen.
And bring them relief. Speak peace to your people.
Amen.
Speak healing and comfort. Speak encouragement and strength. Wherever and in whatever way your people want you to minister to them, to reveal yourself to them, we ask humbly in the name of Jesus that you will minister yourself in a very special way to your people. Reveal your glory to your people. Let them know that you are a prayer answering God. That as they have come before you, you will take care of their needs. So God's children, do not be dismayed.
Amen.
Your God is in charge. He is on his eternal throne. And he will hear your prayers.
Amen.
And Father, even now as we ponder over this text in the book of Jeremiah and realize mothers and fathers weeping for your children because they are no more. They can't find them in the church. We still want to claim your promise that they will come back.
Amen.
So wherever they are, O Lord, minister to them.
Amen.
Through your Holy Spirit, touch them.
Amen.
And draw them to your side. Be with them and do not let the enemy, the wicked one, gain the upper hand. In your own time, Lord, bring them back here safely. We pray for those who are in school, in far distant places, that wherever they are, you remember them.
Amen.
We pray for those who are here. We ask that you bless them in their academic endeavors. And as they go through various trials, various temptations, various mental agonies and emotional problems, you, O Lord, you be the source of their hope and strength.
Amen.
Remember your people. Remember them. Thank you, Lord, that you are a prayer answering God and you hear us because we have prayed in Jesus' name. And now I present again your manservant, Pastor Amangwa, that you will fill him with your Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And through him, O God, we will be ministered to through your word. Bless us and keep us, for we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Happy Sabbath, Church.
Happy day.
Today's scripture reading will be taken from Solomon 2, verse 15. Solomon 2, verse 15. Can you say amen when you're there? Catch all the foxes, those little foxes, before they ruin the vineyard of love, for the grapevines are blossoming. Amen.
Amen.
Before I call the implementation, so I'm just going to introduce everybody that's on the pulpit. So, the one that did our friend press was Belinda Sissy.
Amen.
And the one that did past scripture reading for us was Jennifer Duarte.
Amen.
And the one that did prayer was Sam Lamine.
Amen.
And the one that did welcome was me, Elizabeth Porcelain.
Amen.
So, hymn of meditation will be Dr. Kojo Ansong. After Dr. We'll be hearing Pastor Mankwa. So everyone keep a prayer in your heart for him. Amen.
Amen.
Sister, Strongly believe that God had made the Sabbath rest a way that when within the week we build those burdens from the worries of this world, and on the Sabbath we come here, we come beneath the cross of Christ. So we need to come empty everything and leave light. If you believe that, just shout amen.
Amen.
When the song, the sound of meditation was going on, I saw only one person. I said, we have only one person here who is really understanding the words of the song. I know we do. But we live in a world today that the culture has had made us so rigid that when we come before the Lord, we cannot even express ourselves. But that's not what the worship is supposed to be. The worship is supposed to be a kind of worship that when we stand and we are singing, we will understand and know the words we are singing about. Brethren, let us not be dwarfed by some kind of culture that we think is the holiness of God. We are deceiving ourselves. When you read the book of Revelation, about 10 times the children of God had been in his presence. Out of 10, only 2 were silenced. 8 of them were shouting with joy before God. Amen.
Amen?
Amen? But we have recreated a culture that we think when you come to before God, you have to know holier than thou. Don't even move. Brethren, the Lord requires of us to worship him in holiness. But how do we define holiness? Is it to be quiet? Is that how we define holiness? Just to be, ooh, holier than thou. Brethren, it's high time that the children of God open our hearts for the Holy Spirit to teach us the right way. We know and we believe that it's not by our strength, it's not by our power when we come before God. God has done so much for us. We cannot tell it all. So we need to spend time to praise our God. Amen?
Amen.
If you believe with me, we are going to sing another song in worship. You know my song?
No.
You don't know? MJ6. I think it's MJ6. That's my favorite. So, those who believe in the Lord, who really, really, really know what God has done for you, I want you to sing with me. Impossible if you can stand. Please. Unto you, to thank you for who you are. There is no power greater than your power. Father, this is the Sabbath hours. Your children have come here. It's you who has invited us here just to praise you. For your word says, you, God, you inhabit our praises. But many a times, Father, we steal your praises. But today, we are standing in recognition of who you are. We come with a bunch of praises unto you. You've done so much for us. You've been with our families. None of us are walking on the streets. Father, we are here. Even some of us who are sick, we are here. We just want to lift up our cup of salvation and call upon your name. Receive our thanksgiving. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is excellent.
The scripture reading is found in Song of Solomon. Because when our sister was saying Solomon, right, I heard people looking around. Do we have a Solomon, the book of Solomon? Yes, then we do. It's called Songs of Solomon. Amen?
Amen?
Song of Solomon chapter 2 verse 15, it says that catch for us the foxes, the little foxes that ruin the vineyard, our vineyard that is in bloom. Tree was it? She is a kamankit one. If it's a kamankit one, I'm not saying will be true. In sacrament, one. I'm not saying will be true. We live in the world today where there is no absolute when it comes to good and evil. True or false? Brethren, we are living in a world today that the faith of the fathers right now, even if you consider yourself as a father or a mother, when you were a child, your faith is different from the faith of our children. Do you believe that? We know that we are living in a world that is changing. We are living in a world that even wrong seems right. We are living in a world when we say truth, someone will ask you, what is truth. You can try all the possible means that you have to define what truth is, but the person will tell you that truth is how you see things. That is the world we are living. That is the reason why sometimes you come to church when your children get to some kind of age, they won't come with you. Gone were the days when your father and your mother tells you that, hey, they are past, sorry, we are going to church. You don't question. And now I understand that my mother gave birth to 10 children. 8 girls, 2 boys. Don't open your mouth, it's true. Because our time, it took a whole village to bring up a child. But here, we can do that. Out of the 8 children, all of us were, every Sabbath, we're going to church. The church that we used to visit was Amakum Church. We live in Ashtown. They're close, about 50 meters from Ashtown Church. But Ashtown Church was very small. So every Sabbath, we walk to Amakum from Ashtown. I'm talking about the faith back then, which is different from now. I understand why it worked there, but it won't work today. So during the Sabbath, we will finish everything, everyone will dress up, and we'll be in line, all of us. And my mom will be at the back with a stick in her hand. And we'll be walking from Ashtown to Ankole. By God's grace, after church, there will be bus. You know that the church will organize to take those from Ashtown back home. But sometimes the bus doesn't come. So we have to do the same thing. In line, stick behind us, back to Ashtown. And it was working. And I know one of my sisters always, every Sabbath, get whipped. Because she was the only one who would miss the line. Who will take a different way, and she will get a whip, and she will come and join the line. It was a kind of line no one will see that we are in the line. But my mom knows that we are in the line. And it works. But not today. Today, even if you have one child, they reach a certain age, they start questioning you. You can't say to the child, keep quiet. Just listen and obey. You can't do that today. So our decisions, our mentality has to change. If we do not change the way we used to do things, many of us will lose our children. It's a statement that is coming whether we believe it or not. We need to change our thinking, and we need to change even the way we need to deal with our children. Today, when you ask a child, we are going to church, the child will say, what for? You don't have to be angry. You have to learn to answer the child and give that child the reason of going to church. We need to learn to come to that level, because many of us, we have got some kind of pride which we don't want to talk about. Maybe God is using our children to humble us, some of us, and we need to learn. There are little things that if we do not allow the Holy Spirit to use us, we may lose the kingdom ourselves. Brethren, this happened in the Bible one time. All of us, the adults, we know the story about Achan. And I want us to really go through it for the sake of the youth and for the children. There was a time that the children of Israel, God gave them the permission to leave Egypt to Canaan. They were able to conquer many cities. They were able to go as far as the banks of Jordan. They crossed Jordan, but there was a city called Jericho. This can be found in Joshua chapter 6. When you get time, when you go home, read Joshua chapter 6. And when they, before they conquered Jericho, God gave Joshua instructions. And the instructions that God gave Joshua was found in the Joshua chapter 6. And I want to read from verse 18. God said to Joshua, this city, it was a fortified city. A fortified city, you cannot just enter into it. Maybe that's what Trump wanted to do, to build those walls. But Jericho was already being built. Their city, you can never enter into it unless you go through the gates. And above the walls, they have watchmen on top of the walls. So, humanly speaking, you can never enter or conquer that city without getting into it. But God said to Joshua, I'm giving you instructions. If you follow the instructions, the battle is not yours, the battle is mine. Amen.
Amen.
And Joshua obeyed the instructions. Now, the instruction was so simple, and when you start thinking about it, you start questioning yourself. You know, God has a sense of humor. He was the only one, God is the only one who goes for a battle without any ammunition. He said to Joshua that when you are conquering Jericho, just get the pastors first. You call them the priests. Get 7 priests with trumpets. And get some army in front and some army. And the Ark of God, the priest will be in front of the Ark of God, then the army behind it. All that you need to do, you go to Jericho. You know that it's a fortified city. You can never enter. Just go around once for 6 days. Don't talk. Imagine the first day they went around. Just think about how do you think those in Jericho, the inhabitants, what they would be thinking? What? These people, we've heard about them, that they're so strong. By the way, from the spies' report, those people in Jericho, they were so scared that Rahab was able to tell the spies how their heart had been melted. And because they've heard what God had done for them, used them, or was able to defeat those strong kings, Og and Magog. They got there, no noise, went round and round and round for 6 days. And God said to Joshua that you should give the instruction that on the 7th day, they should go around 7 times, then they'll blow the trumpet, then God will do his bidding. And during the instruction, I want to read chapter 6, Joshua chapter 6, verse 18. It says, and you in any wise keep yourselves from the accursed thing, lest you be accursed. When you take off accursed things and make the camp of Israel a curse and trouble it. But all the silver and gold and vessels of brass and iron are consecrated unto the Lord, they shall come into the treasury of the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
That was the instruction. God said to Joshua, this battle is mine. Whatever booty you get out of it, no one should take anything. It's been dedicated unto the Lord. Now let me come back home. You know, sometimes we play up with the things of the Lord, and we have to be very, very careful. Like anything that is being dedicated unto the Lord, we need to treat it as a holy thing, set aside for the work of God. Amen?
Amen.
Many of us sometimes we say, oh, this is nothing. Something simple like offering plate may look nothing to you. But you just don't go anywhere, just drop it anywhere. They've been set aside for a holy use. Many of us, we may not know that there are some things we do in the church or anywhere that have been dedicated unto the Lord that we bring curse upon ourselves. Including the way we treat our leaders. I got a WhatsApp message. I know we are all getting those messages. Maybe you will remember. I got it. The person sent it from me to me from Ghana. That there was a pastor and a wife were at home, and maybe I don't know whether the pastor was a Seventh-day Adventist pastor, but let me go straight to the point. It was a pastor. But when they were going to church, and while they were at home, the pastor was fighting with his wife. Serious issue. So while they were fighting, the fight didn't end there. It went straight into the car. So the pastor called the son, who was about 11 years old, to come and sit in the car. And we were all driving, mommy and daddy still exchanging harsh words and everything. They got to the compound, you know, the pastor's reserve parking. The chief deacon was standing there. And the chief deacon opened the door and asked the pastor, "Happy Sabbath." And the pastor said, "Happy day, oh glorious day." And the boy looked at his father and looked at the deacon and didn't understand, was confused. Wasn't this man who was fighting? Brother, do you know that is happening even reality to some of us? We come to church immediately, we switch. But at home, we don't, some of us, we don't even talk to our wives or our husbands. Insult them, then we come to church, we meet a pastor or a deacon and we want to hug. There's a man who has never hugged a wife and comes to church and always wants a hug from deaconesses. Brethren, we are living in a world today which you call sin by its right name. We are talking about little foxes that destroy the father's vineyard. There are some things, little things that we may not consider it to be a sin. But many of us, we take curses home instead of blessings because of the way we deal with leaders and the way we deal with each other. This is what this man, Joshua, said, "Don't touch anything, they are accursed. If you touch anything, God, you will bring curse, not to yourself, but you are bringing curse to the whole nation." And please, I want you to understand this. Whatever we do, let us not be selfish. Because whatever we are bringing, there are some people in churches, they are bringing curses to the churches because of what they have done or they are doing, and to the families. So, Joshua gave the instructions, everything was done, victory was for God's people. Amen?
Amen.
When you read Joshua chapter 7, it remained a little city called Ai. Now let me read from Joshua chapter 7 from verse 3. They were supposed to go and capture that little city. Jericho was a massive city. God had helped them. They have won the battle. Now there's a little city called Ai that they are supposed to go and conquer. Verse 3. And they returned to Joshua. You know, they would send some spies there. They would look over the world. They spied the land. Then they brought a report to the leader, Joshua. And Joshua said unto them, let not all the people go up, but let about 2,000 or 3,000 men go up and smite. Now listen to the words of Joshua. Even though Joshua was the leader, and this goes to the leaders. Hello? This goes to the leaders. Sometimes we can be in a position that we may even allow pride to take over us without knowing. Joshua, a leader that God used to conquer one of the strongest cities of his time. Now, when these things came, when the report came to him, Joshua said to them, this time we are going to smite this little city. Now let me ask this question. If there was any glory given about Jericho, conquering of Jericho, whom should that glory be given unto? God. But do you know that the Israelites, that time, Joshua took the glory himself? That was the reason why when he was supposed to send people to go to conquer Ai, he said, just use 3,000 to go and smite them. And make not all people to labor there, thither, for they are but few. And verse 4 says, So there went up there of the people about 3,000 men, and they fled before the men of Ai like dogs. Now I'm adding my joy. That little city, they went, Joshua said, oh, let few people go. But when they went, they were conquered. They ran. And the Bible says they lost about 36 men, strong men. They lost them. They made about 36 women widows. Because of the pride of the leader. Brethren, it's only God who can call us as leaders. It's only God who can equip us to do His work. So when God puts you in any form of position, whether you are an elder, whether you are a pastor, you have to be very, very careful. All that we need to do is to be humble before God. Amen. When we present ourselves in a humble way, God will bring us up. Amen. The Bible says, when the report came to Joshua that they've lost about 36 men, he got upset and went before God and lie prostrate before God with his elders, this time with his elders before God. You see, sometimes we wait for us to fall into trouble before we present ourselves before God. I always say this, there was a little flyer the first time I came to this country. I got it from the church that I was pastoring in Hamilton Mountain. Maybe you've seen that flyer before. It says, if you cannot do anything, or if you fail about anything, try Jesus. Yeah? Why do you struggle and fail before you try him? Why shouldn't you try him first? But many of us, we use our strength thinking that we have the knowledge, we have the abilities. I was in the church for 40 years, I know what I'm doing before we come before God. Why don't we go before God in everything? Spend time in prayer. And that is what Joshua didn't do. Joshua went before God only when they were defeated with those elders. The Bible says, from verse 6, it says, I'm reading from Joshua chapter 7, verse 6. And Joshua rent his clothes and fell to the earth upon his face before the ark of the Lord until the evening. He and the elders and put dust upon their heads. And Joshua said, Alas, O Lord God, wherefore hast thou at all brought this people over Jordan to deliver us unto the hands of the Amorites, to destroy us? Verse 8, O Lord, what shall I say when Israel turned their back before their enemies? From verse 10, now God is going to speak. And God said to Joshua, get up. You know, God has no respect of person, you know. God has no respect of person. So, if you think you've been an elder for 1,000 years, and you get to a point that you need to humble yourself, you need to do so. Before God, we are all the same. Sinners, saved by grace. He said to Joshua, get up. Why are you lying here upon your face? Verse 11, God said, Israel has sinned. And they have also transgressed my covenant, which I've commanded them. For they have even taken off the accursed things. By the way, let me ask a question before I continue. Whose sin caused the Israelites to lose that battle? Whose sin? Achan. That's what we all know. And that's what we all talk about. We always see that there was a man called Achan took some stuff that he was not supposed to take. While everyone was asleep after they conquered the city, while everyone was asleep, this man looked here, there, no one could see him. He jumped into the marketplace, looked here and there, no one was able to see him. He saw best Babylonian garments. Beautiful. Like a Judas Sekente clothes. Being displayed, he picked some of them, saw some gold, silver, picked some of them. No one saw this man, but who saw him? God. Now let me put a pin here. Now I come to the youth. You know, the adults, we used to sing a song. I don't know whether you remember. It goes like this. Oh, be careful, little eye, what you see. For the Father up above is looking down below. Oh, be little, be careful, little eye, what you see. Let's sing the feet one. Oh, be careful, little feet, where you go. Oh, be careful, little feet, where you go. For the Father of us is looking down below. Oh, be careful, little feet, where you go. Amen. Sometimes we go to some places that we think God doesn't see us. You know, Friday night, you wait, your parents go to bed. You've already arranged with someone
Sometimes even they take our clothes first. And we leave as if nothing is happening. Has it happened to you before?
You know it.
Sneaking out. You're supposed to be in church. I'm sick. In the night, in the clubs, you are well. God is watching. We have to be very, very aware of that. We can never hide anything from God. The psalmist says, where shall I go from your presence? How can I flee from your presence? You cannot hide anything. God sees everything. Not only for the children. The adults do the same thing. We plan for so many things that no one knows. The person who knows about is the person we are having that dealings with alone. Then they'll tell you, don't tell anybody. If it's right, you won't tell the person, don't tell anybody. We need to learn from this. These are little foxes that are destroying the Father's vineyard. The little things in our lives, brethren, I can't stop saying it, may hinder us from getting into the kingdom. I know you are here today, knowing that there is going to be a time that we are going to sit before that marriage supper. When you see Jesus face to face. That day, you can't compare anything on this earth with it. So you shouldn't let anything block you from getting into the kingdom. Yes. Amen.
Amen.
That man called Achan, look around, no one saw him, took some stuff, hit them. But when they, in the following morning, no one saw anything, Joshua called for the army, there are 3,000 men, and they went and they lost the battle. That is why God is saying here, it wasn't Achan alone who sinned, but the whole Israel sinned. And I'll call it sin of carelessness. Where was it? Soldiers, where were the watchmen? After the instructions were given, they won the battle, but they had parties and went to their homes and slept. No one was watching the place. Sin of carelessness. That's why God is saying the whole Israel sinned. And he went on by saying, someone has taken stuff. And brethren, the result of what happened to Achan is one of the dangerous things that some of us are putting our hands in without knowing. Achan didn't think about anything. By the way, when you're getting to the end of chapter 7, Achan was found that he was the one who took something, then he confessed. Brethren, Achan confessed after he was caught. Brethren, if you are doing anything, let's confess it now.
Amen.
Don't wait until you're caught. God is God of mercy. He will receive you when you come to Him with an open heart. He knows our weaknesses anyway. He knows that we are feeble. We have some kind of weaknesses that we can take it before God, and God, when we give Him the permission, He will change us. But Achan confessed after he was caught. And what was the result? Achan, his wife, his children, they were not with that father when he went to that place. But it affected all of them. And this is the reason why we have to be very careful whenever we are doing anything contrary to the command of God. It may not come upon us, but our children and our children's children. And I pray that God protect us from the generational curses
that are following some of us. Brethren, Achan didn't know that. But God said, it wasn't Achan, it was the whole city. So we have to be careful the way we deal things, because God is watching us. It was the sin that made them to lose that battle. Is a sin of carelessness and sin of pride. I pray that as we continue this side, the God we serve will keep us on the right track, will reveal to each one of us those little things that we do, those little foxes that we allow it to happen, those mothers or fathers who goes to this place like Walmart or Northfields, and you wheel to where the grapes are, you pick a bunch of grapes and you start eating them before you get to the tills. So by the time you get to the tills, it's halfway. Then you pay for half. Is it a half price? Or those people who go to people's offices to clean. Yeah, you have a contract to clean the place. You wipe the table, you see very beautiful pen. Oh, that's beautiful pen. Oh, I love it. Look at that. Oh, this pen, it can even light. It has a light around it. Oh, a nice pen. Then it goes straight to your pocket. Is that yours? Yeah. You wash, you clean the toilet, the bathroom. You see four toilet rolls. One of them goes to your back. Is it part of your price? I'm talking about little foxes. We need to allow God to remind us to stop it. We need to stop it. Because these are the things that may cause some of us to miss the kingdom. Brethren, you can, if Paul said, Paul, the Apostle Paul said, I had not seen, nor ear had ever heard, nor had ever come to the mind of a human being what God had in store for you and for me. So we shouldn't let anything prevent us from getting into that kingdom. One preacher said, if God used 7 days, 6 days, to create the beauty of this world, you know, sometimes you see some kind of mountains and rivers and how things are going on this earth. You look at it, you say, God is mine. And the Bible says he used 6 days. And Jesus said to you and I that he's going to prepare a place for us. And it's over 2,000 years. And he's still preparing that place. Amen. How beautiful that place will be. Amen. Not houses. Jesus says, I'm preparing mansions. Amen. How can we live on this earth? Just letting little foxes, little things, prevent us from what the Lord has in store for us. I pray that we think again. We pray in our hearts. We allow the Holy Spirit to reveal the weaknesses in our lives, that we'll be able to go back to God and say, Lord, I don't want to be like Achan. And I don't want to be having that pride of Joshua. I want you to humble me. Teach me how to be like Jesus. Amen. And I believe that God will do it. Amen. May his blessings be upon you. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Monka, for the wonderful sermon. So, our closing hymn will be taken from SDA Hymn 308. Thank you.
Is impressing on you to make a covenant with God today. Brethren, we need to come before God that by the time we leave His presence, we will ask God to change us from some kind of weakness in our lives. The Lord wants me to let you know that just search through your heart. And if you really want to make that covenant with God, the covenant that you're saying, God, I'm availing my heart unto you to move me spiritually from this level to a higher level from today. If that is your wish, take that step of faith, move forward, and let's present ourselves before God. To the extent that even if there are some sins in your heart that you can't stop it, take that step of faith. Because we've been in church for too long. God is looking for transforming hearts. Hearts that Jesus can say, this is the reason why I died.
Amen.
Total surrender. Don't look at the person standing next to you. Each one of us are going to stand before the judgment seat of God individually. And brethren, let me say this, I'm not putting any fear in your heart. By the time we leave this place, Jesus may appear in the sky. To the extent that some of us, you know, I say, no, we don't mean any of them, we come to me now. Yeah, we need it. Pay your own machine and then cost for that, but we can't see it. We need to leave it, let God deal with it. Brethren, you can never fix it yourself. But see, genuine, you have to make me as a sign. God can change the leper's heart. The spots, but we need to let Him do it.
Amen.
We can't even praise Him. Because we always look around. You're scared of what people say, but you're not scared what the angels will present before the Father. That's sad. But that is behind the story. And you know the reason why you are taking that step with me. Talk to God. Whatever is within your heart, you will come and be a man, a true son of God. Can't you hear me? A gentleman. You can't do it. Jesus walked on this earth over 2,000 years ago. Almost of the miracles were done, were performed on Sabbath day. The greatest miracle that can ever happen to someone whom the enemy has gripped to be released by the power of the Holy Spirit. In America, son. Thank you for the power, the presence of your Holy Spirit. We thank you for your saving power, Lord. Your children are standing before you. You are the only one who knows their hearts. You are the only one who knows the reason why they are struggling with things. But today they are saying, they are standing before you like what you did with Jacob. They will never let you go until you bless them, until you change them, until you change their names. Please. We are not commanding you to do what you don't want to do, but one thing we know, that you are willing to save us from the ruin of the enemy. You sent the Japan. My buffer can't go on and until you. My name finding certain kind. Will be a war at one red, be a one you. Yes, so. Yes, would you this year? For Casafora. Amen. And my genie and Nagy was our food. We lift our youth unto you, Lord. Your world, the world that you're living in, is different from ours. The struggles and the trials are many. And they are easy to fall into those temptations. Father, it's only you who can strengthen them. It's only you who can make our youth well behave like the three Hebrew boys in the court of Babylon. So we lead them before you. Father, fill them with the power of your Holy Spirit. Sometimes the adults, we do things that we may not even know, that we confuse them. If it happened like that, Father, block their eyes from seeing what we've been doing. Reveal the righteousness of Jesus to them. And Father, give them strength in place of those weaknesses, even in their lives. When they leave home and they're going to schools, Father, let the angel of goodness and mercy follow them. Amen. When those advisors from their peers are coming, Father, let them stand for the truth and for the right and not be afraid in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
And Lord, we lift this church unto you.
Amen.
This is the church that you have bought by the blood of the Lamb.
Yes.
The enemy has no power over it.
No.
So Lord, we pray, committing every family being presented here unto you.
Amen.
That whatever plans the enemy has for them, don't let it be accomplished. Lord, we pray that you build fences around us. And let this house continue to be a house of prayer for all. So if there has been any roots that the enemy had already sown in this temple, we stand in the power of the resurrection of Jesus.
Amen.
To break it in Jesus' name.
Amen.
That your children will come here and receive deliverance. Your children will come here and receive healing. Your children will come here and receive blessings from you every Sabbath, every Wednesday, every Friday.
Amen.
Even in those days that your children passing by, and when they are troubled, and they open the doors, and they come in here and kneel down, Father, hear your prayer.
Amen.
In Jesus' name we pray. Now may the grace of God, the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be upon God's people, now and forever. In the name of Jesus, let the church say.
Amen.
Everybody, just a little quick announcement. Today we're actually going to be having a afternoon service led by our AY team. If most of you can look around the youth, we're all wearing green ribbons, and basically what it's used to represent is mental health. So this week was actually mental health week, so of course we're going to have an AY program about mental health. It's going to be led by Edna, and it's going to start at 2 o'clock. So 2 p.m., we need all of you here back again for our mental health awareness program. Thank you.
Thank you.
Happy Sabbath, Church. And that's my take on my children's department. Yamiya Duma, December 7th is Children's Day, and we want to do a play. There's three plays I have there. One's about bullying, / cyberbullying, child safety, and a social media addiction. And to yes, their parents, we said every Friday, starting from this Friday, yeah, the kids have to come to church, starting at 8 o'clock to 9. So yes, their parents, we now said, and crowd, everybody should be here from starting this Friday, going until December 7th. No? So that they, yeah, every child can participate. Every child is included. If it's young, you know, if it's chance to get to know. So I'm going to show 8 to 9 every Friday. That was it. Thank you.